Good evening, and welcome to the March 19th Wyndham Raymond School District RSU 14 Board of Directors special meeting agenda. The time is now 5:38, and if we could have a roll call.
Yes. Kate Bricks.
Here.
Eric Colby. Jennifer Fleck.
Here.
Diana Ferguson.
Here.
Marge Gavoni.
Here.
Pete Hensler.
Here.
Don Perkins. Jerry Queen Dwyer.
Here.
Rena Sangster. Kate Mueller.
Okay, if you could join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
First item on our agenda is an executive session. We will go on in for an expulsion hearing. If I could have a motion, please.
I move to approve going into executive session to consider the possible expulsion of a student pursuant to 1 MRSA 456B.
Second. All those in favor? It is unanimous. We are now in executive session. Good evening. We are back from executive session, and I will take a motion.
I move that the board finds as follows: that the student's actions were deliberately disobedient, that the removal of the student is necessary for the peace and usefulness of the school, that based on these facts, the board hereby expels the student effective immediately for an indefinite period of time, and that the superintendent notify the student and his parents of this action in writing with a copy of these written findings of fact and conclusion. And furthermore, a reentry plan will be prepared by the superintendent in consultation with the student and his family.
Second.
All those in favor? It is unanimous. The student is expelled. We're going to take a 5-minute break, and we will be back. Back from break, and we will now have the presentation of our fiscal year 15 RSU 14 budget from Superintendent Prince.
Thank you very much. Great to be here. Excited to talk about the budget for this year, FY 15. It's an opportunity for us to really learn about what the budget entails, and I think you'll be surprised with some of the good information that I'm going to share. First and foremost, I would like to start by saying that, as you know, this year, the girls' varsity soccer team took first place in the state of Maine. And not only did that happen, but they were recognized in the Sports Illustrated magazine. And Coach LaBelle was also recognized for receiving the National Coach Award in the United States for soccer. So, wonderful opportunity for the district, and this is just one example of the great work that's going on. So it's all about good stuff going on in the district, and I'm just really proud of our students. The budget challenges we'll talk about tonight and what we offer in the district. We'll talk about who we are, and we'll also talk about the budget and the figures. And at the very end of the budget, there are some resources for the public if they want to learn more about what this whole slideshow entails. We do have budget challenges, not a surprise to really anybody. And first, I'd like to just talk about the more the state level compared to New England. If you compare the state of Maine with the other neighboring districts, you can see that the state of Maine is not keeping up with school spending compared to Connecticut, Massachusetts, Rhode Island, New Hampshire, and Vermont. So again, school spending is a challenge for us in the state of Maine, but we're weathering the storm. In addition, this report came out yesterday by David Silvernail, Dr. Silvernail from USM, and he did a study talking to all the districts, all the superintendents in the state of Maine. And the number one issue is the lack of state funding to support schools in the state of Maine. Second issue is the high level of poverty among students. And the third, it's very difficult for districts to compete with the external grants, the national grants, and to receive funds. Great study. I can't say that I've read the whole thing, but I think it's a wonderful study that really talks about the state of Maine and some of the challenges that we're faced with. As you know, job cuts have occurred during this recession, and for 4 years of cuts right there nationally, we're really faced with a lot of school cuts and the school spending that's going on. In addition to that, another challenge is the lack of special ed funding and Title I services, money that goes behind that. Just in 3 years, we've seen a reduction by 23%. So not only have we received difficulty at the state level, but we're seeing a huge issue at the federal level with school funds. Curtailments, again, it's been a challenge for us. We pass a budget, we get into the fall, and the state then curtails our money, and they say they need to have some money back. So I'll start at the bottom of that slide, FY09, just over 600,000 that was curtailed. FY10, just over 900,000, and FY13, close to 200,000, which gives us a total of curtailment 1.7 million. A lot of money in 3 years that we have not been able to receive that we had been counting on within our budget. So another challenge. This year, the Finance Committee gave us a direction, and we came back, recommended a 3.7 increase in the budget. And as you know, starting tonight, you will hear the cost center presentations. This is really an opportunity for me to turn the budget over to you and for you to go through the workshops and learn about the budget. And ultimately, you will have to give a recommendation at the end before we go to the public for a vote. So it's all part of a process. Other challenges, as you know, charter schools is now in law. And just for next year, FY15, unfortunately, we're going to have to budget just over $130,000 for charter schools. That comes right off the top. Our health insurance, you think it would be close to the cost of living increases, around 2% or whatever, but it's at 9.5%, just the budget for health insurance. Negotiations, it's a year that we have three contracts open, and we're negotiating those contracts, and obviously there'll be an expense to that. In addition to that, the good news and bad news are vocational schools. We have more students going to our vocational schools, so there is an increase of $110,000. That's something that I would say is good news, but it is have a budget figure next to it that increases the budget. Last year, the Department of Ed, State of Maine, shifted the health insurance costs to local districts. So we've had to take that on both FY14 and FY15, and that's about $500,000 that we did not expect. So that's a shift in money. That and the charter school is a big hit, I think. In addition to that, as a board, you're working on facilities, and as you know, our middle schools are challenged with the age of those schools, and we're going to have to do something about that down the road. And I know we have a committee working on that, but that is a challenge that we're going to have to be faced with down the road. So we're overcoming the hurdles. In addition to that, when we think about a school budget, we're pretty labor intensive. And so fixed costs, if you just look at fixed costs, electricity, salaries, just to open the door, it's roughly about $1.6 million for the RSU 14. That's just figuring out that everything, that status quo is about $1.6 million. In addition to that, the state of Maine back in 2009 had hoped to get or felt obligated to fund schools at 55% with the essential program and services. And EPS, what that basically is the state of Maine has looked at a typical school system and said, this is what we could support. These are the programs and services that we can provide, and we will give you money towards that. Now, that does mean that some school systems want over and beyond. They might want, like, foreign language, where EPS does not count that in. So foreign language is something that a school system, if they wanted that, they would have to budget that over and beyond the EPS model. Point here is that we've never been able to get the state of Maine to get beyond 46% for school funding. We had counted on 55%, but they haven't been able to get to that level. So that's a challenge. And there's a lot of discussion about that to maybe change the EPS model. Not sure that's going to happen, but it would be nice at some point in time to get to what the law indicated at 55%. In addition to that, Oxford County Casino, Department of Ed, State of Maine had promised that those funds, the $13 million, would go towards school funding. That's never happened. We had kind of was hoping that would happen. We weren't counting on that, but it would have been another opportunity to increase the funds for school funding. A lot of unfunded mandates every year. We have about 100 bills coming out of Augusta that have to do with schools and school bills, and most of those mandates require some type of funding. So as we think about this, if you took the charter schools money and you took the retirement funding alone and took that out, I wonder if I could just lift this up a little bit. Oh, shoot. Okay. If you took those two out, you would be that slide's not showing that.
40,555,586.
What percentage is that? 1.6. So if you took charter schools and if you took the retirement system out of that, that alone would decrease your budget by 1.6, which would give you a grand total of 2.18%. And the point of that is those are costs that were just thrown on us this year, and even though we're asking for a 3.75, if we did not have charter schools, if we did not have the retirement funding, we'd be at 2.18%. Another challenge that I think you need to know about. The good news, I think we have a really good value in this organization, and that really is what I want to kind of talk about at this point in time. I think RSU, the essential question is, are you getting a good value for your buck? And when you look at all the good reasons up there on the slide, 254 reasons why students should come to RSU 14, I think you'd be definitely saying, yeah, you know, this is a really good school system. We've got great things going on here. We've got great people. It's a strong organization, and people are really proud of RSU 14. It is about our mission, success for all. Whenever we develop our budget with the administrative team, it always comes back to our mission. We're definitely a K through 12 systemic district. It's not like every building has a different plan. K through 12, we have a mission, we have a vision. We met with the community, we talked about what they envisioned RSU 14 looking like. And up there on the slide, you'll see some cylinders down below. And actually, that work right in there is the work that's going on now. We have task groups, and each month we talk about the evidence of those task groups and the work that's being done. Really exciting work, and I think what's important here is that this budget supports the mission and the vision of the district. Another good value when we look at how we compare to the state per pupil costs, and this is 2011 and 12, that we're below what the state per pupil cost is by $437. Again, that was 2011 and 12. Some people would say we should be beyond that because we're a more wealthy district than maybe what the state average is. But again, I think you're getting a good value for your buck when you compare us to the state. If we bump it to 2011 and 12, a different year, our per pupil cost again is still lower than the state. The state was just about 9,700-ish, and RSU 14 is just over 9,000. If you compare us to Cumberland County, we're close to being at the bottom. And again, the story here is we're really doing a pretty good job, given the amount of money that we're putting into RSU 14. And for the most part, we are at the bottom of the Cumberland County comparison. I'd like to think that we're maybe could get there up in the middle. We've done a lot of reductions with supplies and materials. It's gone on 7 years now that we've continued to reduce the budget. Student attendance has been a big focus. We know early on in early childhood, elementary schools, bad habits develop. It's going to carry all the way through. So we've really worked hard on student attendance. And if you look at the chart here, all 4 years, we our attendance rate is higher than the state average. We'd like to even get better at that. I'd like to see that like at 96-97%. And we're really working hard to try to make sure that those good habits happen at the elementary level. I think that's really critical. In addition, when we compare our student attendance to the other districts in Cumberland County, this is just a gauge to show you that RSU 14 is doing very well by trying to get our students in school. And again, this has been a huge priority. High school's over 1,000 students. We are right up there, and our enrollment, again, if you look at kids who are dropping out, is very low, 1.6% compared to other high schools that are basically the same size as us. So kudos to the interventions, to the real school, to RLP, to the policies and practices that we have in the district, trying to make sure that no student should be able to drop out. Here, this slide shows the good work from our staff. We have so many creative, innovative teachers who love to try to find a few extra bucks to try it out in their classroom. And just since July 2012, we're well over $400,000 in grant money as well as donations. The backpack program, we have a company donating money to that. And we really appreciate any donations and any grants that we can receive. Up here, I wish I could see the top of that slide. Thank you. The administrative costs, sometimes people think districts have too many administrators. When you compare us to other districts in Cumberland County, we're pretty low. And part of that really happened, I think, through consolidation as well. When we consolidated, we made some changes. And again, I feel that we're pretty lean, but when it compares to other districts, we're doing very well in that area. So reductions as a result of consolidation 2009 to 2014, those are the positions. And sadly, I'm to say that we've had 71 positions reduced in the RSU 14, and we've taken a hit. It's been very difficult, very challenging. I think it's hard for the culture. People don't know if they're going to have a job the next year, and so it's hard work. It's been another challenge. EPS, Essential Program and Services, and I know for new board members, it takes a while to really kind of grasp EPS, but again, what this shows with the RSU 14 is that compared to other districts, we haven't put a ton of money over and beyond what EPS is. We have really tried to be conservative with our budgets. But if you look at more wealthy towns, they might have like foreign language starting in first grade, and they can pay for that. And they've made that choice. I think it's trying to find that balance. What can you afford, and what can you provide? So I think, again, compared to other districts, we're kind of at the low end there. Our journey, I'm just so proud of the district. So many good things are going on. And even though we have a lot of challenges, every day something comes across my desk that is just great news. And when you look at a timeline, it is the evidence of the good work that we're doing. It is by having that mission, it's like, oh my goodness, things are really coming together. So we have an incredible, wonderful workforce. Every teacher in this district, as you know, is working really hard, and we really appreciate that. Enrollments, again, looking at the largest districts in the state of Maine, there's over 204 districts, and we're number seventh largest one. And sometimes with larger districts, you have more challenges. I just thought that'd be good information for people to know. We're still growing a little bit here as the RSU. Wyndham High School, very pleased to be recognized by Newsweek. Again, they're trying to identify the best high schools, and kudos to the high school staff and administration for the good work on working on the graduation rate, college acceptance rate, average SAT, ACT scores, and the AP scores as well. We could always do better, but again, we were recognized, and we appreciate that. We're very much about data-driven. Christine Hessler does her annual achievement report. Building principals do a yearly report. We really look at student data, and that drives the work within the district. And again, I just wanted to mention that because I think it's a really important piece of our work. We've done an incredible great job with increasing the AP courses at the high school, and I think that is really the way to get rigor. And I just hope we can continue to get more students get into those AP courses, and that's why it's important that we don't reduce staff, particularly at that level. The more courses that we cut at the high school, kids will end up in more study halls, and it's just not a good thing to happen. Very pleased with our graduation rate compared to particularly the other high schools or districts that are our same size. The RSU 14 is about 92.7%, and that's very good when you compare us to the other larger districts as well. So our budget before you is just over $41 million, and that's about $1.5 million more from last year, FY 14, and that is a 3.78% hike. Looking at this chart tells you, if you look right up here, the Raymond Wyndham total, that's when we were not consolidated, and we're just over $38 million. And Don, that slide up top, is that the...
That's total budgets.
And that's not the spending, that's the...
That's the operating budget.
Yeah, okay, thank you. So the story here is that we have held the line incredible. We've increased or decreased the budget, but if I was able to show you the bottom of the slide, in the 7 years that we've had a budget, the average increase is about 1%. Now think about that, because just to open the doors, it's 1.6%. In the last 7 years, if you average it out, it's been about 1%. So you know that we've made reductions. I mean, that the 71 positions really has impacted this. Addition, state subsidy, if you look at that, if you look at all 7 years, the state has really only given us about $89,000 more. When you look at the state subsidy from when we were not consolidated and putting those two districts together, and you subtract FY15, the state really has only contributed just under $90,000, where you as a district has contributed about $2 million plus. So the story here is state subsidy has just not helped at all, and it's been a real challenge. Where the money comes from, again, you'll get a handout tonight, so some of the stuff you can look over at your leisure. Money comes from really the local district as well as at the state level. And then you can see there's some federal money, carryover, et cetera. Again, how the budget is allocated, it really generally goes for instruction and certainly salaries. And that kind of breaks it down to give you an idea of where the money goes. encourage the public to come to any of our upcoming meetings where people will be presenting the cost center presentations. We'd love to hear from you, and if you can't make it, certainly you can email us or call us, whatever works for you. And ultimately, we hope to have a budget by June 10th, which is a referendum. Again, it would be wonderful if people could really come out to that. Sometimes we get a low turnout, but we really would encourage people to keep that date on mind, June 10th at 6:30. And the big thing here is, yes, it's a great value in this organization, and the kids really shine. And I think you know that as a board. We have some wonderful students, and we're just really excited about the good work that's going on here. So it's my pleasure to turn the budget over to you, and hopefully you'll get a chance to really learn about the budget through the cost center presentations. And I thank you for your time, and thank you for the community. And if they have any questions, or if you do, I'd be happy to answer them. And let me give you the handout now. Get some handouts.
Sandy, where can the public get this information? Is there going to be a book at the library, or?
At the library, it will be online.
It'll be online as well?
Oh, it's great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good.
Wonderful. Okay, moving on. And Sandy, thank you very much. Look at that. Look at that time, huh? You are good. The next item on our agenda this evening is we will be going into
Kate's name on it, so.
Oh, wow.
Executive session. What we will do is we will be combining these two executive sessions. So the motion to go into these will be to read both of them, because they're similar. The second one we vote on, so we will come back out to vote. So I can make that motion if you want.
Go ahead.
I can explain it.
Would you explain it again?
I can. We have two executive sessions, and they will be on discussion, and it has to do with negotiations, two separate contracts. Mm-hmm. But there is nothing that says we cannot go into executive session and stay in executive session, because these are similar.
What do you mean are similar?
They're similar. They both fall under the MRSA 405-6D.
Oh, as far as the
right
legalese.
The content, yes.
So we're going to discuss one, and then those folks are going to leave, and then we're going to move on into the next.
Well, the first one will be us, and the folks are coming in for the second one, because that's the one we will vote on. The first one is an update for the board.
Okay.
Can we make the motion? Make it easy.
Please do.
Okay. I move that we enter into executive session to discuss contract negotiations with the Sebago East Shore Education Association pursuant to 1 MRSA subsection 405-6D. And while we were there, we will go into executive session for discussion of negotiations between Raymond Wyndham Educators Association Educational Support Professionals. And we will move to enter into executive session to discuss contract negotiations with the Wyndham Raymond Educators Association Educational Support Professionals pursuant to 1 MRSA subsection 405-6D. If I could have a second.
Second.
We could have combined this as one.
Okay.
Okay.
That's good.
Okay, all in favor? So we will do the first one.
Right.
Yes, this was written up.
communications team.
Okay, well, welcome back. We have returned from executive session, and I will take a motion on the Wyndham Raymond Educators Association Educational Support Professionals contract.
I move to ratify the Raymond Wyndham Educators Association Educational Support Professionals contract for July 1st, 2014 through June 30th, 2017.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. Before I move on here, is there, I believe there is public comment.
Good evening, I'm Barb Murray, and I'm the president of the Raymond Wyndham ESP. And I just wanted to thank the board as well as the negotiations team, and also, in particular, Roger Young, who was our facilitator. All of us working together were able to do an interest-based negotiations and finish negotiations in a record 2 days. So thank you all.
Thank you. Okay. Yes. I will take a motion to adjourn, and be it known that we will adjourn. We'll take a 5-minute break, and then we will return for our workshop session. So if I could have a motion, please.
I move that the special meeting be adjourned.
Second.
All those in favor? It is unanimous. We'll be back in 5 minutes. Good evening. Good evening. We are back for our workshop session. Tonight we'll start the cost center presentations for our FYI 15 budget. Just a little bit of housework here. All questions would please go through the chair. When the presentations are made by the directors of each group. The first one will be Bill Hansen with facilities. There is time on the agenda here that he will do his presentation, and then there is time for the board, for you folks who have not been here for these, there is time for the board to ask questions of here. All of the public comment will be at the end of the presentations in total, not after each one. And I ask that everybody please keep in mind that we received the books later than we had planned because of the snowstorm. So, you know, there's an understanding that there's going to be a lot of stuff that people really haven't had a chance to look at. And I'm sure if Don can answer it easily, he will. Or if, say, Bill, for example, can answer it easily, he will. If not, we'll take down the questions, and for the board, you know, he will get back to you. Mm-hmm. Either Bill or Don will get back to you with an answer. On the public input, it'd be a similar thing when you get up, because you are not allowed to direct your questions directly to the who had presented it. Please direct them to the board, and we will make sure that if we can't answer them, if they can't be answered this evening, you will be answered. Somebody will get back to you.
Excuse me, Marge. When they answer whomever, whether it's the board or the public, can we just make sure that everybody gets the answer and not just the person who asked the question?
Right.
Okay. Thank
okay,
you.
Excellent. Okay, saying that, Mr. Hansen, you are first with facilities.
All right, good evening. I'm not going to go through my budget line item, because I know you got a long night ahead of you. So I'm going to talk about some of the highlights, some of my concerns, and then open it for your questions, just to keep us on task. Really, pretty much, you look at the facilities budget proposed for 2015, it's a flat budget with a very small increase. The increase is primarily focused on salary and benefits. You look at the staffing, you're going to see there's a small change in staffing. In that it shows a portion of the interim business coordinator was an addition to my staffing level, and then you'll see that there's actually a reduction as well. So my total overall staffing is nearly neutral. It's a tenth or so less. We had hoped to hire another full-time grounds person. At this point in time, we have two full-time grounds crew at the high school and one up in Raymond. And we're trying to maintain 11 fields in the high school with two people. They do an amazing job. Mike DiDonato, I would put him up against any other grounds coordinator in the state. I think our fields are amazing. What we have done very successfully is we have hired temporary staff to help fill his needs spring, summer, and fall, and it's worked real well. The challenge with that is that you spend a lot of time bringing those folks up to speed, and then they're gone, and then you're kind of repeating that process. But we've been successful. Mike's worked real well at that capacity, but it is a challenge for two staff to maintain the level of conditions around the schools and around the fields that we're looking at, but they do a great job. When you look at the operations side of my budget, if you look at salary and operations, that had a reduction of about $35,000 in the operations side. So it puts the facilities operations side at a level that's below fiscal year 2011 funding. So if you think about your own personal bills at your house, 2015, 2011, that's kind of where we're at. So the impacts of the proposed budget we put together is, first and foremost, it's going to be a delay in the primary school project element number one. And real quickly, for those who weren't part of that board discussion last year, the primary school site work project has four elements that we looked at. Element one is reconfiguring the front of the school so that we have separate parent and bus drop-offs. We have over between 70 and 100 parent drop-offs every day at that school. What we did this past summer, because of the late approval of the DEP permit, we were able to put in a temporary parking lot, which is supposed to be staff parking, and we're using that for parent drop-off to separate the buses from the parents. It took a little bit of a learning curve. It certainly is an improvement now, because the children are getting out on the sidewalk coming right to the school. So I feel that from a safety standpoint, I'm much more comfortable with where we're at, but it's not the end state that we want it to be at. So element one was to create that separate bus and parent drop-off. Element two was the side parking lot, which we have in. We haven't done the top course of pavement on it, because the plan was to complete that when we did the front part of the project. And we've got a little bit of cleanup to do over the winter, as we've learned how some of the drainage has occurred and some of the challenges that happened. And that's pretty typical when you start moving that much earth around. Element three is the two playground pods. We did get one in before school started. The plan would be this summer would be to put in that second element. The $198,000 that we did not put in the budget would have allowed us to complete elements one through three in their entirety. So I am looking at alternatives. We have some money in our capital reserve fund to move portion of the project forward. I'm going to be talking to Sandy about getting on the agenda item to talk about that in the near future. So that what would require would be board approval, because it's a change in the project, because you approve the project in a certain order, so it would require board approval. If you would choose to move forward with the funding, we have to get some of it done. We would then have to get town and DEP approval, because their approvals are contingent upon the certain schedule that we had, which would be changed. I'm confident we could get an approval to make that happen, but it would be a change. So that's something that I'll work with Sandy to get on the agenda in the future. But right now, as we're funded, that project won't go forward as we are presently set up. And then also, there's unknown timing of element number 4, which is expansion of the playground fields and the ball field, because that was additional funding that was not approved by the board last year. It's right around $500,000, plus or minus, to complete that. So that timing's unknown. And then the thing that probably concerns me the most is deferred maintenance. I'm going to talk some more about that. When you look at the spending in my budget, really, there's operating maintenance, which is your fixes and repairs, your plant inspections, your filter changes, that type of repairs that you have in a facility of our size. You have what we call MIP, which is maintenance improvement projects, which generally are cash purchases as we look at them. And I'm going to put it in real simple terms. When you decide to remodel your bathroom, it's been there for 20 years, it's time to refresh it. You're not adding new capability, you're just keeping it so that it's current, okay? Then we have capital improvement projects, tend to be larger in size. It might be the equivalent to if you're going to add a sunroom onto your house. It's a finance project generally, and it generally adds a capability. We look at projects to date that we've done. A good idea of to look at MIP project would be like the masonry work that we've done at Jordan Small. That really didn't add any capability to the building. It's a repair item. It's made the exterior building envelope better, but it hasn't really made the building any bigger. It hasn't added a new capability. It's just kept it in good space. You look at new capability we've added, like the changes to the entries to the buildings. That's a new capability we didn't have in the Wyndham schools. That's kind of the difference between them. And then the fourth tool we have is capital reserve, which is money that gets funded by the board into capital reserve, generally towards a specific project. The board did put money into two projects in the capital reserve most recently, one for some looking at some HVAC work in the middle school in Wyndham, and the second was to look at the site work issue at the primary school. Kind of give you kind of a rule of thumb. If you look at the assets of RSU 14, you know, we can kind of have discussions about the actual number, but we're looking at around $174 million worth of building. That's just the cost of the brick and mortar and land and development. So you're in that range right now. So in the perfect world, in my days when I was in industry, I'd say you try to shoot for a 2% of capital spending each year. If you think of 50 years replacement, 2% is a really nice place to be. I was never really at that level when I was in this industry. You strive to be there, but you never got to that because there was always challenges as well. We're running about a 0.2%. So if you think about that, that we would look at a building life of around 500 years, which I can't do that. You know, it just isn't gonna make it. So, you know, and this isn't new to schools. I mean, You've all seen the news about Rumford schools having issues with roofs, and this isn't new. Everybody's challenged with deferred maintenance because it's money, and you're talking about big numbers because of the fact that the plant is physical plant so big. So one of the challenges that I'm concerned about, really, for concerns going forward, is really is the sustainability we have of our current MIP CIP spending levels, because they're lower. We're right around a little over the $300,000 range when I look at the total numbers. I may be off a little bit, but it's pretty close. But we're not anywhere near the. I'd like to see us be at double the triple that number in the perfect world. I also realize where we are today, that's not going to happen at this point in time, but that's kind of where I'm at. The other concern that I have in the budget going forward is really volatility in the energy market. I was at a seminar on Monday looking at some of the challenges that happened this past year around energy. We are very fortunate. We locked in our natural gas at approximately $12 a decatherm. And we looked at the spot market as I was reviewing it at that seminar I was at on Monday. On Tuesday. The challenges is this, the spot sell on natural gas at the peak of the shortage was around $78 a decatherm.
78?
78. Okay? So we were very good that we were locked in. I'm very glad that we were locked in. We will pay a higher margin price when we're not at that high peak demand, but the real problem is the pipeline that's leading up to New England isn't big enough to handle the capacity. And the plan that was put together, which is a good one, was they put an LNG facility in Boston to serve as a capacitor to put gas back on the line. Unfortunately, the market for LNG has grown such that they were found they could make more money by selling it as an LNG product to other places that were looking for it in this cold winter than putting it on a pipeline, so it became a real struggle. So that has a real impact on both electricity and natural gas costs. Now, through a lot of work with conservation, we were able to absorb about a 40% gas increase this past year without a budget increase. And that's just been looking at working on schedules, keeping energy and keeping heating levels at a certain at optimum levels, and probably a little colder than most staff would like it have it be, but you know, I'm trying to stay within the main energy guidelines. But going forward, I'm concerned not this year but next year, we may not be able to continue this flat funding at that. It's just going to be a challenge. And the unknown is the impact on electricity, because a lot of electric generation is moving to natural gas because of people are really trying to, you know, shut down coal plants. New plants are going offline. So we have most of our energy contracts are up in December of this year. So I'm feeling I'm in a pretty good place through December of this year, and I think I can get through the following months. But going forward, you know, the volatility, I don't know where we're going to end up. We've had some pretty good contracts. And again, generally the way that process works is I work with Mr. Davis's and our energy consultant. We bid that stuff out, and then we determine kind of what is the best time frame to lock into that market. So that's pretty much what I have on my presentation for tonight. I don't know what questions you have on the different line items, but that's kind of where I'm at this time.
I'll tell you what, why don't we, if you have questions, why don't we do a question, and then we'll move on to the next, and you get to ask all your questions so that if a lot of questions, then it won't matter. But that way everybody, you know, gets a chance to talk. So. There's no question.
Oh, I have a question. I didn't know where we were starting. Okay, I'll ask the first question. You had talked a little bit about the primary school phases, and I wasn't here when that was all decided. I was just confused a little bit about the playground. I think you said was phase three. I know there's been a lot of public fundraising for that. Is that in addition to what we'd have to budget, or?
Yep, great question. What was agreed upon is the school has set up a lease payment for playground replacement. The funding that was agreed to by the board was $100,000. And it was agreed upon that the playground fundraising work, which has been an amazing piece of work, would cover the cost that would be up and above that amount. So the playground that we have priced out is around $120,000 in value. And the cost, we've even got more playground because of the community build, the other work that has happened that's really helped extend that dollar, it's really with an optimum situation. So that's the fundraising is covering that gap between the 100 and the 120, providing the community build. And there's some other things that they'll be looking at. You know, you build a playground, and you change that whole site. There's things, I know Michelle's looking at benches. We're looking at possibly putting in some borders around the playground areas that we would buy, which would be a cost on top of that. So the playground funding is really to give us those extras to help us get to the end of the project.
Okay, thank you.
I do, but I'm willing to let others go. You talked about natural gas. What do you think about the oil that is being used up in Jordan Small and RES? Because they're on oil and we're on gas.
That's correct. So far, what I do with that is I look at the kind of, there's a couple websites I look at for futures for oil to understand kind of where the market's going to be. So far, 2 years in a row, the price I put in the budget has been above what the market costs have come in. So I'm not going to tell you that I'm perfect and I get it all figured out, but so far I'm 2 for 2, and the information I've gotten so far looking forward doesn't show a huge move on the oil price.
Okay.
So I'm confident that the number we have is still going to be okay.
Okay.
The challenge we've had is that, you know, how cold is it going to be? degree days this year have pushed the energy budget well above where it normally would be. I do try to budget energy very conservatively because the last thing I want to do is come see you all and say I need more money for to heat the school so the kids are going to be cold. So that's really, I do look at that. Now, in the perfect world, I'd love to put a pellet boiler up in one of those schools and get on a renewable. It would be great, but that's adding capability I don't have, and I want to deal with breaks and fixes as well. So, you know, I'd love to talk to you about that. I think it would be a great opportunity to go green. Mm-hmm. But there's also a whole stack of projects before that are just repairing the issues we have now.
Thank you.
Well, that's mine then. On the primary school, it says the delay of the completion of phases 1 through 3. Now, does that mean none of those, or are they linked? The phases 1 through 3, do you have to do all three of those?
I would prefer not to complete like the top course of pavement on element number 2 until we did the work out front, because it gives you a cleaner finished product when you're done, because you're going to be tearing up the driveway pavement almost from the front edge of that new parking lot all the way around, and you see it every time you try to blend in a top course, you get a seam, and then over time that's where you have challenges. So I would prefer to leave it as it is now and get that top course done when the site work out front is finished up. It's usable the way it is now. We are going to be doing some minor repairs to deal with some of the drainage problems we had as a result of really unanticipated water coming off that field onto those sidewalks this past year. We're going to have to add a swale to address that, but I'd rather wait on that. Now, as far as 3 goes, the proposal I'll be bringing to you to talk about changes does involve completing element 3, which is the 2 soft play areas. In fact, in my budget, there's $15,000 to help continue that work. So we are pushing towards completing element 3. The challenge with that would be is that does not include any of the expansion of the playground space. And for those of you that weren't with us, if you look at the work that we're doing, we're not providing the space that PDT would recommend you'd have for a school that size if you were building it today, because we're constrained by wetlands and other challenges. But we've gone pretty much as far as we can to do that. So the space we have now in actually both elementary schools is really below what you'd really want to have for space. And if you've been at RES, we've got a plan to expand that area in the back too to get to that level. And again, that's not funded. So to answer your question, I've kind of gone around the barn here, Marge, sorry. I would choose to complete the phase 3 at this point in time with the money that's in the budget, and I would not complete. I would choose not to move forward with the completing the pavement in the element number 2 until we finish the work out front, because I just think you're setting yourself up for problems. I think the base pavement will be fine for another year or two. So
your thought is to use what you have created, that temporary drop off area.
Would stay as it is for until we complete the front of it. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
And you know, we looked at, is it possible? I've quite looked at, can we do part of the front and not part of the front? And it's just so interconnected that it would really be, I'm afraid we could start school with a real mess. And I really don't want to. I think you need to, when we get to the ready to make that move, just commit to it and get it done. I really need the whole summer to do it because of the time frame, and trying to get that finished and grass seeded before kids get in and back, and even that will be a challenge. But really need to start when school is done. And of course this year has been a challenge that we're going to be in school another week later that we would have lost if we were started. So
anybody else have?
I have one more.
Go ahead.
You had talked a little bit about the maintenance of the buildings, and you know, 2% being what you'd assume for a building to stick around 50 years. I know we're looking at challenges with the middle schools. Are you increasing how much you have to spend on those schools just because they're going to be deteriorating faster?
The middle schools in general, what we are doing with both middle schools is we are doing what's necessary to make it a safe environment for children. If you look at back of your bathroom, the toilet's working, the sink is there, the countertop's there, the shower curtain's there, but it's not going to be maybe what you'd really like to see for that environment, but it's all safe and working. That's kind of what we're doing right now. I mean, there would be a lot. I would come to you with a whole list of things I'd want to be working on in those middle schools if the decision was made by the board that we're going to remodel those schools.
I'm just wondering if it's getting more expensive over time because we haven't come forward and done those big remodels yet?
It certainly is.
Yeah.
It certainly is adding up, and it just in my position has been until we kind of have a direction as to are we going to remodel or are we going to do something different, I would hate to put in that new bathroom only to then tear the house down a year later. So anytime we have a situation that's not safe, then we're going to get it corrected immediately, just because that's what we do.
Thank you.
No. Thank you. We've had a lot of snow. I believe it's snowing out there even as we speak. And I'm just wondering if that would impact your plowing budget or how that works. Is it every 3 years, or can you talk a little bit about that?
Actually, what we had is a 3-year contract with the option of 2 renewals.
Okay.
And our last renewal was this year coming up, this next fiscal year. Glidden has been the contractor for that. And we have a fixed contract with them for provide an operator with that loader with the wing and the plow. We pay for the diesel fuel, which actually was a very, very good choice because our purchase price on it is going to be a lot less than a contractor would be able to buy it from. So that works nicely. And then we augment that with our own people. So this year we're going to have more expenditure for a lot of reasons. One, a lot of the storms have happened at nights and on weekends and even some on holidays, which has been detrimental, and all the towns are feeling that.
Mm-hmm.
And then it doesn't really cost us a lot much money to plow a 2-inch storm than a 6-inch storm, because I'm still plowing, we're still treating the roads, and mm-hmm. sometimes those 2-inch storms of the ice around the buildings, we've spent probably more money than we spent a long time on ice melt trying to keep our walkways safe, and that's been a challenge, been a real challenge this year. So I know we have a higher expenditure than what I normally would have. I do try to budget that line with enough money to anticipate some of those additional costs. We always with the hope that at the end of the year I can say, Don, we didn't spend that $6,000 or $7,000. I budget extra, and that can go back into the general fund or into the, I guess it goes general fund, right? Okay, thank you.
Just a little bird walk on that same issue. The middle school up in Raymond, Jordan Small Middle School's roof, we've talked about that for several years, is needing to be replaced, and I'm wondering if you've noticed with all the storms, and has that deteriorated further because of the weather or no?
Well, that condition up there, we're holding it at bay through an awful lot of preventive maintenance and then actual leak call maintenance. For you, those of you who aren't familiar, the Jordan Small Middle School has what's called an inverted membrane roof. So what you have is you have a steel deck, and then you have a isolation board, which generally is a gypsum, and then you on top of that you have a membrane, and on top of that you have a separation sheet, and then on top of that you have insulation, and on top of that you have stone. So when you're going to look for your leak, you have to literally remove the stone, remove the insulation board, remove the separation to try to get to the membrane to find it. And most traditional flat roofs, and I'll tell you, flat roofs properly maintained are great for a school because they don't allow snow and ice to slide off the building, which causes all sorts of other problems, which are a real challenge. So to find that, you literally have to dig through it. Now, think about what that's like when it's got ice and snow that have packed on there and melted and frozen, and now you're trying to find that leak because it's rained and now it's an active leak. It's a real challenge. Our roofing contractor, Genie Roofing, has done an amazing job. The protocol we have up there is when we have a leak, the call is made that day, and we usually are serviced within the day or so after that. So that's been our approach. It's probably not been the lowest cost approach as far as moving forward, but it's an approach I have to take because I'm not going to allow that leak to occur and continue because there's too many of the problems that happen after that. So we're holding it at bay. It absolutely needs to be replaced. And I'm going to start getting into some issues with other schools that need either have renovations or school roof replacements too, because you look at now you're 10 years into the high school project. So I'm going to start getting into needing to do some renewals or renovations on some of the rooftop equipment that's on the building. Generally has a 20-year guideline life, and if we do renewals probably at 10 to 15 time frame, we're going to be able to extend that out. So it's these things all start to kind of build up like an airport that isn't landing planes. So I don't want to paint a picture that we're in dire straits here either, because we're not. And I'm really very fortunate that I think that this district is very very had a lot of good forethought on maintaining the facilities. And we have had some good funding. Just the last two or three years, we've really been at least half the level that I'd like to see us at because of various reasons. And but there has been some real good work done. So I think it's just mindset for you to go going forward that, you know, probably next year I'm going to have to come with more of an aggressive plan dealing with capital improvements. And I think it will be clearer if we have a better picture as to what we're going to do with middle school. It will help me kind of paint that picture a lot better.
You had mentioned before getting onto Mike Kelly's home down there at transportation, those two trailers
yep.
that are down there. Because I remember there was an issue with mold, and anyway, yep. it's not a terrific thing. Are they going? Is there a
the current budget has a lease payment for a replacement of the two trailers with an actual a bus office area. Bus garage office area, which includes a space for Mike to meet with all his drivers for training, which is really important. He has to do that. It would be ADA compliant, which we're not right now. Which and we get around that by coming meeting at the central office is what that workaround is. So again, I got to be careful as I say this, not to get you into alarm. There is a workaround, but it's certainly not one that we'd want to continue. So there is funding in there to do that, and it is the funding is offset by savings. Of about, Mike will correct me on this, but a little over, I think, $11,000 in lease payments to the trailers that would go away. So we are looking at about a 10-year lease to complete that work. And I'll be bringing that project to you, I'm hoping, probably in the May timeframe. We've been working with PDT. We have a design put together. We're trying to finalize the work so we can put out an RFP to get pricing on it, and then come to you with actual physical pricing for the project. And again, it would require your approval.
Great, thank you.
Just have one final. We got an email, I don't know when it was, yesterday, today, whenever, about the water situation up in RES, and it's finally clear and we're in good shape. Do you see, I mean, that's a permanent fix. We're not as permanent as it can be.
Well, in the perfect world, I wish Portland Water District went into that building because my life would be much easier. We are on wells at both the two Raymond schools. And that requires us to have an operator, which we have a contracted operator that runs those water systems for us because they're public water systems. So, you know, what happened sometime between last spring and this fall, we developed a crack in the casing that allowed surface water into the well. Okay, I have no idea how that happened. You know, we did have an earthquake at one point in time. I guess that could have been it. Could have been shift in the ground. I mean, so anytime you're looking at a public water system, this isn't uncommon. And there are some schools that have public water systems that have those challenges that they are on a full-time chlorination system that are just treating the water that's coming into the building. So no time was it unsafe for children. I have a kind of protocol that if we fail a test due to groundwater contamination, which basically means there's some bacteria in the water, is we go to bottled water until that's cleared up. I think it's the right thing to do because it's best for kids. So I can't guarantee you that in 5 months from now we couldn't have another issue there or across the street because it is a public water supply. You know, that's why it's required to be tested. The state, you know, is on top of us on that, and we follow those requirements, the letter of the law. So, you know, it's pretty common to have a test that would fail. The nice thing is that I've seen now that we've had testing in February and now March that shows that there's a lack of that bacteria, so we're looking good. But I hope I don't get an email from me tomorrow saying that. It's always a possibility because we don't, you know, I don't have control with, you know, we're at the kind of the mercy of what's going on with the aquifer and surface conditions, and we're going to get a good melt here. So, you know, we're going to get a really good idea of that has worked well because with all the snowpack we have. Mm-hmm. We should be seeing in the next month or two. So I was encouraged that the March results came back because we have had a little bit of, not as much thaw as I'd like, but there's been a little bit of opportunity for bacteria to come in. It hasn't happened. So
Thank you.
Anybody else? I guess that's it. Well,
thank you, Bill.
Thank you, Bill. Thanks for all your hard work. We appreciate it, and we know this is not an easy thing for you because we know you would love to do more.
Well, I just, you know, I'm very fortunate. I have a great staff that if you go into the buildings, that staff is they're committed to the buildings. They work really hard to keep them clean and looking nice, and it's really awesome for me to be able to work with the staff I have, and I have a lot of fun. And you know, the two gentlemen over here, you know, really support me in a wonderful way. So it's all good stuff.
Thank you.
We have some of the friendliest custodians as well. They're always smiling and friendly and
congenial
and helpful. So
great. Thank you.
Excellent. You have great staff. Okay, the next cost center and the presenter is Jeannie Riley for our food service.
Good evening.
Motion director.
Marge.
Microphone.
We have Don explain, because this cost center is just a little bit different than the rest.
Sure.
I'd be happy to. Thank you. Mrs. Bricks is referring to is that this is actually not in your operating budget book, because it's funded through federal funds and obviously the money that people pay for the lunches. On the other hand, it is what we call an account that we want folks to have transparency in terms of what it is in terms of the revenue and the expense. And the board some 2-3 years ago asked if the food service director could come and outline their expectations of the program, the expenses and whatnot. So I appreciate that. Thank you.
Well, yeah, that was my introduction.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay. I just to in the beginning, just to explain our the school nutrition program doesn't use funds out of their general fund. We build our budget based on a forecast of revenue from federal reimbursement for the meals that we serve, revenue from parents paying for school lunch, and revenue from extra, you know, we do some catering, we sell things outside of the meal program, bottles of water and bottles of juice and things like that. All of those things generate revenue for our program, and we kind of forecast that and then build our budget based on the forecast, what we anticipate where we'll be, and take into account historically what our revenue has been like last year and the year before and the year before. So that's kind of, we kind of start with that piece and then kind of work backwards. And that's what we've done. Affecting our budget this year are several things. Meal participation, which continues to increase, and we've seen a huge increase in breakfast, which is really great. We've worked really hard to get the word out about breakfast, that breakfast is free for kids who qualify for free or reduced price meals. Breakfast is a great deal. Even if you're a full price student at $1, $1.25, it's a great benefit to families who are busy. So we've seen a 10% increase in our breakfast participation, and that's great. Even lunch participation is up 2%, which is small, but still, when you look at the national average for school lunch programs, most school lunch programs are seeing a decrease in lunch participation of at least 10%, and that's in the state even. Many of my colleagues are, you know, what are we going to do? Our lunch participation is down this much or that much or 10% or 5%. But we have not seen that at all. We've continued to see growth over the past 10 years. Every single year, we've not had a dip. You know, we may have one school that's down, but we seem to have another school that kind of picks that up. And so that we've had like a 2% increase so far this year. So that's affected our budget in a positive way. More meals creates more revenue, but it also creates more expense as well. The more meals you serve, the more money you spend for food. In another increase to our revenue piece is that meal prices continue to increase. We're required by law to increase our meal prices. Part of the Healthy Hunger Free Kid Act of 2010, there's a clause in there called the Meal Equity and Meal Pricing Clause, and that means that you cannot charge below what the reimbursement is for a free meal. So the reimbursement for a free meal is $2.99. And we are not at that level, but then there's like a formula in there of how fast you can increase. But the goal is to have parity in that amount. Like, so if the reimbursement for a free meal is $2.99, what we charge for a full-price lunch plus what we receive for reimbursement for that full-price meal, because we get even a little bit of money for a full-price meal, should be getting closer and closer to that $2.99. So we will be increasing meal prices again just because we are required to by law. So that affects our revenue in a positive way. It increases the amount of money coming into our budget. Decreasing our revenue, what I am anticipating is that there's more restrictions coming. We've had a lot of restrictions, a lot of changes in the meal plan, switching to whole grains, requiring students to take a fruit or vegetable with every meal. All of those have affected our, you know, how we prepare a meal. Starting in July of this year, there will be a new regulation affecting what we sell outside of a meal. Bottled drinks, snack type items, those are all going to come under a new regulation. Very recently, in the last month, it's the USDA has said that there will be a waiver for schools for a 1 year kind of pause for that. Like, we won't have to comply in this July, we would have to comply next July, and I actually am planning on applying for that waiver. And one of the reasons I am planning on applying for that waiver is that the USDA has been for the last 2 or 3 years very kind of wobbly on what they roll out. They roll out a regulation and then they kind of go backwards. They do that, they say do this, and then 2 or 3 months into it, well, wait a minute, we're going to change our mind about that. I just like to wait and see what's going to happen. So I will be applying for the waiver. I have no idea whether the waiver will be approved or not for this district, but it will give us another year to kind of see where the dust sort of settles. Can we sell, can we sell a bag of Cheez-Its? Can we sell, because currently we wouldn't be able to for next year. So many things. So, it has to be fruit, or it has to be a vegetable, or it has to be, it's kind of crazy. It has to be whole grain. We're gonna kind of see where that, hopefully we'll be able to see where the dust settles, because a lot of the revenue generated from those extra items that we sell help to make us keep our meal prices something affordable for families. Staffing-related costs also are having a negative impact on our budget. Keeping our participation up, keeping our customers happy, and staying current with all our state and federal guidelines really require that we have a skilled and, consistent staff. And the costs associated with employing and retaining skilled staff are increasing. And I know Bill just talked about that, too, the health insurance benefits, just what we pay our people. The more we require them, serving breakfast and lunch requires a longer day. It just requires a lot of people to put out close to 1,800 meals a day that we do, lunches, because on top of that, we do about 700 breakfasts a day. So that is really, the increase of health benefits is really impacting our budget quite a bit. Cost of food and supplies is also impacting our budget. Just, I'm sure all of you know, when you go to the store, things cost more. And we feel very committed to feature fresh fruit and fresh vegetables in our program, to offer students a wide variety of fresh food and food as much made from scratch as possible. Those things cost money, and that's really impacting our budget. However, on the flip side of that, we are trying to utilize more commodity foods that we get basically for free from the federal government, and also trying to utilize scratch cooking and training our staff to make do, or utilizing the commodity food but turning it into something that students will want to eat. And we've been using our chef that we have on staff a lot for doing things like that. So equipment costs are another big thing. Bill talked a lot about how the buildings are getting old, and that is the same thing with food service. Our equipment is getting old, and especially at Wyndham Middle School, and he talked a lot about Wyndham Middle School and Wyndham Primary School as well. We have equipment in Wyndham Primary School that's wasn't built to deal with the number of lunches that we're serving down there every day. We're up to almost 500 lunches a day. 250 breakfasts a day, and that equipment wasn't just, that building wasn't, I don't know how many students that building was built for, but we're serving way more students than that kitchen was kind of intended for. So new equipment is expensive, but necessary. And then for our program, I have a section that I just think has made us kind of a stellar program in this state, and I call those kind of value-added things. Our program, our school nutrition program, continues to support a backpack food program where we send a backpack of food home with over 150 students every weekend to help if they're basically families that are food insecure who may need just a little bit of help. And we feel like doing that not only helps the student, the family, but it also helps that child come to school on Monday morning ready to learn. So we feel like we're supporting that program, supports the educational system. If that child comes to school on Monday morning having not had enough food over the weekend, it's going to be a catch-up time. And we want those students to be ready at the bell on Monday morning. And we feel like that sending a backpack of food home can help support that. And our program supports that with administrative people to help run that. We're teaching cooking classes for students of elementary school age. We're having chef events at every school. These are things that are not normal for a school nutrition program, but we feel like these are things that make us better than everybody else. We are currently being recognized on a national level, on a state level. We've been featured in the Huffington Post for school nutrition programs who are doing things outside of the box. All of these things take a lot of work, a lot of skilled staff, a lot of dedication. I think that these are things that kind of go into our budget, but also things that help us generate revenue on the other side by gaining parents' trust, by gaining new customers, by getting recognition. Parents are feeling comfortable sending their children to school to eat with us breakfast and lunch. We are currently sitting on the School Nutrition Association's Kitchen Wisdom Panel, where we're actually a test site for recipes that for all the schools in the country. So all of those things are great things for us that kind of help us to grow our program. Our goals for next year are to continue to grow participation without increasing our labor cost. We don't want, you know, while that's kind of the balance. Increasing participation does increase your food purchasing, but you want to do it. It takes about the same number of people to make 100 lunches as it does 150 lunches. It doesn't take a whole lot more people. We hope to and plan to redesign and expand our catering, the catering end of our business, which will in turn generate more revenue for our program. We hope to research some new areas of revenue, possibly serving some coffee at the high school level, which is an okay thing to do. Even under the new guidelines, you can serve coffee. Just kind of maybe looking at that as an option. We don't really know what that would look like. We continue to purchase cooperatively with other school districts in the area throughout Cumberland and York County to get the best bang for our buck on all of our supplies, all of our groceries, milk, produce, all of those things. And our purpose, our real purpose, is to support the education system of RSU 14 by ensuring that children are well-fed and ready to learn and able to retain what they learn here. That's really all I have to say.
Of course. I didn't even have to.
But I don't have to be first.
You go for it.
First of all, I think it should be said that you were acknowledged, I think, as the state nutrition director. Do I have it right?
I was the regional school nutrition director of the year for 2013.
And first of all, I want to congratulate you on that.
Thank you.
And
thank
it's
you.
Through your leadership that we've really gotten all the recognition that we have. So thank you for that, because I think we really are stellar thanks to you.
Well, thank you. It does take a lot of people. I have a great staff.
But you're leader of the pack, but I know that everybody else contributes, so thank you for that. I wonder if you can talk to a little bit about the free and reduced lunch numbers. I know they continue to go up, and I think the last number was 37%?
About 33 district-wide. Our highest schools are around 37%. Okay. The high school kind of is lower, so that kind of it kind of boils out at about 33%. Does continue to increase. I think a little slower than like maybe last year it was up higher, but they do continue to increase. And I continue to believe there's families out there who aren't even filling out the form. And we continue to try and reach out to them in as many ways as possible, making the form available on their website. You know, we talk about it in all of the letters that go home. But I feel like there's families out there who are just not accessing this benefit, and that's one of our goals, is to make that as kind of out there as possible, and yet at the same time as anonymous as possible, if that's even...
I think that's the key.
Yeah, I mean, you have to make it everybody know about it, and yet once people... qualify for the benefit, making it as anonymous and as private as possible.
I think that's what we thought when we instituted the swipe, was that that...
And it really does. I mean, lots of time my staff don't even know. As a child goes through and pins in their number, it's very seamless. All students are doing it. All staff are doing it. When they're making a purchase, really no one really knows.
Have we made any inroads in the high school? Because I think that's the toughest.
We've definitely seen a big increase in the high school. When I started here, it was maybe... around 20, maybe even less, 20% free or reduced. We've definitely seen a big increase there. And we've seen a big increase of students at the high school participating. Since I've been here, it's like phenomenal, like 300% increase in participation at the high school level.
Well, I'm happy to hear that.
Yes.
Can't learn if you're hungry.
And there's still lots of room to grow, too. I mean, because we were just feeding, so many kids were just buying a la carte items and weren't purchasing a lunch, like maybe 80 lunches, and now we're easily many, many days at 400 lunches a day at the high school.
That's fabulous. Thank you.
John?
I just wanted to add back to the prior topic, which is Sandy and I were able to go to a meeting where Justin Alphon spoke in behalf of food service across the state, and they've done a study, which I haven't been able to gain access to, but his words were that in the state of Maine, only 70% of the people that can take advantage of it do. And if you just kind of do the math on 33%, that's more like half. Half the population could be eligible, which is scary on the one hand, but at least there is, you know, federal money there as well.
Thank you. Looks like you're increasing your staff to some degree. I know it's all within your budget, so I'm not really concerned about it, but because you're serving more meals and having more participation?
We've done some changes of our staff, and I think if you're looking at numbers, it's probably not as clear, but we've done some changes. We have hired a manager for our high school, and that was our middle school. We hired a manager for our middle school. At the same time, we kind of decreased a helper position, so it was kind of a trade-off there. But there has been that increase, and probably not as big as the paper that you're looking at, but there has been an increase, and it's really just increasing people's hours to accommodate for the more meals that we're serving.
Okay, great. No, I'm not questioning. Sounds like you need to do that, so that's great. That's all I have.
And I think one of the things you're seeing is, because I looked at, like, the increase of the supervisor position, which actually last year we had Stephanie Joyce in that role, but for some reason it's not showing up that way, and now when Stephanie Joyce left, we hired Sam Gasparo in that position, so it looks like an increase, but it's an increase that happened a while ago.
Okay. Great. Thanks.
Go ahead, Eric, and then Peter.
Okay. Thanks, Jeannie. You do a great job.
Thanks.
And a lot of the guidelines you have to work with can be difficult.
Very challenging.
We'll put it that way. I had heard that they were going to increase the sizes a little bit again. Is that true?
The size of the meals?
Yeah.
What they've done is last year they had limits on the amount of protein and the amount of grains that you could serve. There was a minimum and a maximum. They've done away with the maximums. So... like, instead of only 2 ounces of protein, which isn't a lot, if you're thinking about a 2-ounce hamburger patty for a high school student, that's not very big. They've done away with that maximum, so now you could, without having a penalty or anything, you could go up to a larger portion. We still have to meet caloric guidelines. So there's calories and protein and fat. We still have to meet all of those guidelines, but they've done away with the maximums as long as your menus meet the other guidelines.
God bless you.
Thank you.
All right. I'm not sure this question may be better directed for Don, but in this mass, I'm not seeing revenue numbers. Like for your department, do you know how much revenue annually you
bring? I do. I forecast my revenue, as I said, and I have forecasted about $1,555,355. I have a sheet if you'd like to see that.
No.
Okay. And that's just a formula we put in
so you all get it.
Based on the meals that we serve and historical data of, you know, how much catering we've done and federal funding for our meals, things like that.
Okay, yeah, I was just trying to get a feel for whether it's a break-even operation, whether it's a revenue-generated operation or an actual cost center.
Go ahead.
It is a situation. Actually, I'm glad you asked the question because new board members wouldn't be aware of where we've come from with this program, which is prior to Jeannie joining us, we actually had 3 years of very significant in the red numbers for this program. So your operating budget actually carried a number to help support and supplant this this operation. So since that time, that's changed dramatically to the place where actually money was being put into undesignated fund reserve for that program. Legally, any money that is captured or made, if you will, from that program needs to stay with that program. You don't have latitude as a board to kind of move that money, which is fine. But that has been how, in addition to just the fact that I said it's now in the black, she's paying for the equipment, you know what I'm saying, that you would have probably had to have budgeted for. Now, I don't know how long we can sustain that sort of thing because we did add, some staffing, which she's talked about, that is really engaging the clients, if you will, to utilize the service. But for now, I can't tell you how proud we are of her to have done that for us since she's been with us. So it's a big deal. And I don't know if you know in general what the percentage of state operations, food service that are in the black, but I can imagine it's not very many.
There are not very many. I have a few friends that I know that are, but not very many.
So we're fortunate.
Just to follow up on that note, and you had talked about the age of some of the equipment and blah, blah, blah. I mean, I don't mean that way. I shouldn't say blah, blah, blah. Okay. Well, it's 10 to 9. But anyway, do you anticipate, like, some substantial purchases? And
I have a fairly long wish list, okay. But within my budget, I have a probably $50,000 worth of equipment that stayed in my budget. I put a lot in. I took some out to bring it to match my revenue that I anticipate. I have about $50,000 still in primary school's budget for stuff that I just know really needs to be purchased to make us able to do what we need to do down there. There's equipment that's tagged out. It's not safe to use. We're not using it. We're limping along without it at this point. And some at the middle school as well for those same reasons.
Do you know offhand, and I can get it later, but our fiscal year ends June 30th, like what your balance was?
No, we've used it,
over.
As I've just said. It's a guess, but I'll get you the actual. I'm thinking it's 50,000, but I'll find out. Yeah.
And along the equipment line, would that require any additional use of space, or is this new equipment just same size, can just handle?
Yeah, it actually would probably require less space just because new equipment is smaller than some of these old steam units and things like that that were even at primary school, which isn't that old, some of the equipment in there is quite large. I think that it won't require any extra space.
What's happening with the summer lunch programs? I just heard something quickly in the news and wasn't sure if a law was passed that we might be required.
That particular law only pertains to schools that have an overall free and reduced percentage of over 50%, which we do not. So that doesn't, then yeah, I mean, we're quite a ways off from that. However, we do have a site down in South Windham where we aren't servicing that site. It's serviced by St. Joe's. It's a free summer lunch site. It has been at, help me out, Marge.
at Little Falls. It has been at Avesta, but it can no longer be held there. So there was a meeting, excuse me, and what it is we had to find a pocket within the community that the feeling was would contain, if you took just that pocket, it would reach the 50%
right.
and above level, and that pocket did. So right now we're in the process of, in the plan right now, thank you, Bill, is to use the outside area at the John Andrews School
oh,
on
perfect.
High Street,
yeah.
Because that's really all they need.
Mm-hmm.
Avesta did not work out well. One, it's on 202, so it's very highly traveled.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have access to the building, which they wouldn't have at the John Andrews either. But there's no shade. There are no trees at Avesta. And the John Andrews School does
yeah.
have it. And where we are in the process right now, Samantha has talked to Bill, so he's pretty much cleared us using the property up there. And I've contacted the town because the next step is we need a letter from the town stating that area that we're looking at, that address, meets the same qualification is within the realm in South Windham that would cover it. So therefore, the program will be able
oh,
to continue, and it'll just move, and it's 0.4 miles around the corner.
The meals for that program are delivered from St. Joseph's College. They actually get the reimbursement for the meals. We kind of partner alongside them by advertising this, you know, kind of doing some of the legwork for the site, advertising it towards the end of the school year so that families know that their children can go get a free meal there, things like that.
It's not part of the RSU budget, not part of
it is not part of our budget at all. And there, we do have some things, picnic tables and an awning type of, not a tent, but, you know, an awning type of canopy thing that we had grant funds to purchase for that.
Anybody have anything else? We are all set.
Great. Thank you so
you
much.
Jeannie.
Thank you very much, Jeannie. As usual, you're doing a great job and all
Thank
your
you.
Staff.
Thank you. It's my staff. Like,
oh,
I just kind
staff.
Of... stir up the pot and they make it all turn into something
no
really yummy.
No
you, tell you what, you make a great team. How's that?
Thank you.
Okay, the next cost center will be transportation. Mike Kelly?
Bring on the buses.
Yeah, bring on those buses.
Please don't be on them.
Hi, Mike.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I apologize, I'm a little under the weather, so if you don't understand what I'm saying, just please ask. My name is Mike Kelly. I've been here, believe it or not, somebody asked me this morning, how long have you been here? And next month will be 6 years already.
Right.
We're getting old. Dirt.
Seasoned.
Seasoned, yeah. Right.
Very good, Eric.
Anyways, like my colleagues that came to you before myself, I'll just try to give you a overall summary and probably more of the highlights. I think what is a misperception of transportation is that it's to and from school during the school year. But what has evolved over the years is it's more a year-round operation, believe it or not. And many, many times people have asked me, geez, what do you do during the summer? Put your feet up. And it's probably the most challenging part of the school year because of preparing for the next year and the differences in special education as far as the needs and the logistics behind it. So it does prove to be pretty challenging. This year's budget, and I think in the cover letter that I had, there were some significant decreases that have been noted over the years. Instead of going over each and every one, as a department, we've been really aggressive, and especially consolidation had given us some one-time opportunities that we took advantage of. And one of the things that I missed, and I apologize for this, because we're going through so many versions when we're going through these reductions and where we were actually going to be when we came to you folks, is that what I had put in there was a 2.9% less than it was in FY12, which is incorrect, because the version that finally came out, and it was some last-minute adjustments. You look back to FY12, even though it's a $56,000 increase this year, which is about 2.6%, my overall increase dating back then is only $4,000, which is about 0.25%. And so that's because of a lot of aggressive measures that have been taking place, which I outlined. We had eliminated some routes. I had an assistant part of the management scheme that we have eliminated. The other pieces is that in the van transportation and the aides that support the van drivers, there was several what we call benefited positions. And the positions were not eliminated, but the hours were reduced. And the reason for that is there were so many competing needs from the various schools that there was overlaps. And certainly, as you could understand, we're unable to meet all those needs. And, of course, it did not make sense to pay those amount of hours, but we had to get some people because we had to be at certain places at certain times. And so that was just the result of those type of requests. The what's interesting, and I think Sandy had this in the our local publication, is how many miles we travel on an annual basis. And this is collective miles. And understand is that it's not just we support vehicles from the real school. This year, starting this year, a couple years back, too, is from SEA. And we also support the fleet from the facilities, too. But in FY13, so the mileage is still accumulating for FY14, but last year we were a little, just about 713,000 miles total, and probably the previous year was about 725,000. So when you have a 12,000 mile swing, it could be a bunch of variables, but that's typically what we put on collectively as a fleet. What's interesting is that of those numbers, the special education requirements probably total about almost half of that. So it's about 48% each of the regular routes and special education. And believe it or not, real school probably is about 24% of that. So real school is putting on about almost 25% of our total mileage, which is significant in itself. On a daily basis, what we deploy is that we have 23 regular runs. And the interesting piece here is Sebago at Alliance. When we were in Gorham, I think we had one van. Now we're up to one bus and three vans and the drivers and aides. So that in itself has been a significant increase for a small amount of students that we are transporting there. Our daily morning, afternoon special education bus, we have one that's deployed. And we also have five vans that we deploy for just district-type functions to and from school. And so as you can see in the positions in that cover sheet, we actually had a slight reduction in folks, but it's like portions of positions. And as I mentioned to you earlier, it's a part of a position. It was of aid that had some benefits, and a driver, van driver that had some benefits. But you also see in the bus drivers, there was an increase of a 0.5. And last year, I think it was after the budget had been adopted, it had been requested of me that we put in place a run for those volunteers from Wyndham that would like to attend Raymond Elementary School, which we did. So that's where that 0.5 comes from. So when everything trickles down after the reductions, the additions, and this year's budget of 56,000, like that 0.5 position is about, in itself, is about 18,000. There's also a school bus. We're replacing two school buses this year. This is one of these years, and Don and I and the previous boards have been working very hard to try to build in a capital replacement plan, because we're deploying 33 buses. At one point, we consolidated with 38. We're down to 33 now. But what has happened is that in our inventory, we're seeing buses that are 15, 16 years old, and they've passed their life cycle. And it's not so much the powertrains in those, it's the significant body deterioration in those buses that we just can't keep up with. But that's where the challenge lies. But part of the capital replacement plan is that Don and I have talked about that. We typically engage in a 5-year lease purchase. And in this particular year, I think the previous years, we're fortunate enough that we're retiring two leases. So we simply take what the value of the bus is versus 5 years ago, and we just increase that. So the increase in the budget was rather insignificant, relatively speaking. But this year, we only retiring one lease. So that's why you're seeing that. It's about $19,000 per year over a 5-year period for a lease purchase, because the value of the bus is around $85,000 to $86,000. Some other interesting pieces, and I'm kind of going back a little bit, is that when I talk about the fleet and what we do, is that another significant part that we do during the course of the year is athletic and field trips. And when I tell people how much activity that takes place on an annual basis, and actually we implemented the software, it's a trip tracking system that we put in place in 2010, late 2010. So what it really does is track our overall activities. We have about 1,100 trips a year, and that's not vehicles, that's trips. That's a combination of when we support, like, Wyndham and Raymond Recreation, special education activities, athletics, and just everyday field trip activities that go to wherever, whether they go to the state house, state museum. There's a variety of things which they do. So that's another part of what we do. And actually, I've said just between athletics and the daily needs and logistics behind special education, it almost occupies about 3/4 of a person because of that high level of activity. So in a nutshell, that's what we do. I'm trying to keep it short. I know you may have a bunch of questions. Some of you have asked the questions many times before, and some of you newcomers.
Mike, just so the new folks will understand how, or maybe it's Dawn, how we buy buses.
Oh, there's actually the state of Maine, because they provide funding for it, have through the purchasing agent at the state level now go out and competitively seek prices for buses, and we piggyback basically that activity.
Right. We have to. The state provides the specifications on the bus, and there's three major vendors, and we are not locked in at the lowest. And typically, it depends what our experience has been, without getting into any particular manufacturer right now. There may be one that's the lowest, but our experience to this point has been just to sustain those buses going forward, even brand new buses, it's been, in some cases, it's an eye-opener. So that's why we may go with another vendor that may be slightly higher, but they're all in the same ballpark.
So actually, when at the end of the year, when we think about what we might be able to do to reduce our lease purchases, this is one that we would not be paying off in advance, because we do get 100% state funding for those that are approved. So those leases we stay with, and that's why Mike's had to work so hard to keep away from the peaks and valleys of the purchases of the capital equipment.
You're it.
How is it without having an assistant? I mean, just, all right, don't answer that. Let's move on.
It's great.
It's a picnic, right?
Absolutely. I got to see Jordan Small a lot more.
Because I know there's a lot of phone calls from parents and follow-ups, and that takes a lot of time.
Yeah, it's interesting is that some days it's like sometimes you try to manage and you have a good plan, but sometimes you come in, it's management by crisis, and sometimes a single event can consume your whole morning.
Yeah.
So it depends what it is. It's always a challenge, because certainly we have a very, like, it's not unique to us. We have a very diverse district, and expectations are different, and they vary widely, so it becomes a daily challenge.
This really, I guess, is not a question for you. It's a question for Mr. Davis. Will you explain to me why, and I probably ask this question every year, and of course I don't retain anything, so.
Let's hope I did.
you don't remember me asking, so it's all good. Why athletics cost is embedded in his. Let me back up. There's always, with the $2 million budget for transportation, there's always been in the past board members who really, you know, it kind of curdles your stomach because it's $2 million that's not going towards instruction. And then you see, you have the folks in town who see so-called empty buses or a bus with one, and which is all a misconception because there's, you know, it's all legit. Everything that we do is legit. So to get to really drill down and to get like a true transportation, my two questions are this. Why are athletics embedded in this and not flopped over into the athletic budget? And also, why are the ed techs for special education considered his staff and not special education staff?
Actually, if you look at the book, you'll see that the some of the cost controls do identify where they are charged. So it's charged to the site, for example, or a program like the high school athletics, middle school athletics. So it is delineated.
So what are you saying, they are charged?
Yes, it's delineated that way.
So is it out of, is his a net amount strictly for getting to and from school?
No, it's not. In terms of his overall operating budget, it would show those expenses, but what we're saying is the state is breaking down those expenses to the sites and to the specifics of what it's for. I'm not sure if I'm answering your question.
I just want a clean figure for transportation that doesn't include.
Yeah, I mean, it'd be very easy for us to aggregate that.
Can you do that?
Yeah,
I just would really like to know what it costs to get kids to and from school without athletics. Are field trips charged to you or are they charged to the site?
They're actually capitalized in mine, but we are not each and every field trip, but we are reimbursed by the site.
And it does show by site what's
right.
Carried. So I think I have, let me get it straight. I have to and from versus athletic, but you
right.
also want athletic, I would think.
Yeah, I want athletic because I want to know that's, in my mind, part of the total athletic budget is the cost of getting kids wherever they need to be.
Yeah.
And then the other thing is, what do you do with the ed techs that are riding on the bus that are assigned to?
Those are under special services in terms of the cost for that.
But they appear in the two.
They do. That's right. But again, they're broken out. So I can. Yep. Okay.
Thank you.
Yep. What I did want to say, may I? Just
yeah.
One moment. When we talk about essential programs and services, this is a bit of a sidebar, but athletic transportation is one of the costs that are not included in the EPS formula. So when you have local additional costs and we're over EPS, another example is AP courses. So you saw the long list of AP courses not included in EPS. I just wanted you to know that's not a bad thing. I just want you to know why those numbers
right,
sometimes
right.
grow. Yeah.
How are we getting so close to the EPS then? Because I feel like I haven't seen you've had on that slide zeros and 1% above, if I was reading it correctly.
Right.
I would expect we would be a lot more, because we do offer foreign languages.
Yeah, we are more. As it turns out, as time has gone on, even though our percentage is lower, so we're showing you a percentage on that at 6%, if I recall that correctly,
okay.
That probably represents $4 million. So
okay.
It's a bunch of money. Yeah.
Mike, can you give me a sense for, like, the lowest occupancy runs that you have? Like, how many students would be in the lowest?
That would be, what's interesting is that we're undergoing, the Wyndham buses, especially the elementary buses, were running ballpark 45 to 55, right in there. And when we talk about capacities, and I think what's a misconception when you see the legal capacities on the side of the bus, comfortably in the larger buses that we have, if you sat two to a seat, you could sit 52, two to a seat. If you start stretching some of them, especially at the older grade level, if you start going three, it's a problem. The lower capacity buses are in Raymond, and that's just because of enrollment. And you'll have probably 25 to 35 on those particular buses. And as I said to previous boards, too, is that capacity is a challenge in itself, but what you have to have equal weighting is distance. And so when you have a larger geographic area, i.e. Raymond, because we have less buses, you're going to tend to have less students on those buses because of the time that they actually travel.
Okay, and then focusing more on, like, the vans, do you have van runs with one student or two students on those? Or
it could be. It could be because just based on what the competing needs are. And it's interesting, somebody sat in the office again last week, and we're talking about, because there was different challenges going on, and so how do you keep this all straight? So if you see a van running down the road with two kids, it may be that they're just dropping out of sight and then going to another site and having two others. Probably a good example that you would see students that maybe a single one in a van is like Sebago Ed Alliance is a good example. But you need to understand special education is just it's a unique challenge in that when we transport students through their IEPs, there's certain requirements. And sometimes because of those requirements, it has to be a one-on-one transport. So when people see that and they become upset, it's not because we elected to do that way. It's just necessary because of that student's needs. So that's where people just become alarmed sometimes. But it is what it is. That's
Going back to Kate's question to you, Don, and maybe you can, is it like breaking out like maybe the special ed and then it says like real school is a 20% of 25% of mileage? So maybe if you could break it out. I don't really care who pays
for
it at this point, but just in terms of what, you know, what is it to do the regular ed, special ed, real, Sebago Ed Alliance, I guess, is one of those, and athletics would be great. So Mike, with the bus van aids, are those special ed that are in your budget? Are those special ed? Okay,
yes.
The van drivers are special ed?
Yes.
Okay, that's all.
Hi, Mike.
Hi.
Question I have is, being someone that's new and doesn't understand a lot of it, when you say special education, I've noticed as I've been reading up on that in the last few months, that's changed from when I was in school back in 1970s. So when you say a portion of that, what is that? I guess I'm trying to get an idea of what the special ed needs are for transportation. Someone that couldn't ride on a regular school bus?
Right. Not necessarily each and every student that has some designation would have to have special transportation. Sometimes students that are in the special education status will ride regular transportation. But what tends to happen as the year rolls out, there's issues that evolve which cause them to reevaluate why they have to go to special transportation. And that is one of our challenges here, is to keep our arms around it. Because, as you know, is that people come, people go, and so when those challenges come to us, they're on our doorstep at any given time. And now here's the wild card in the room, too, is that what we're seeing, especially with the economy, is more homeless students. And so we have the requirement to share the transportation responsibility. And that student may come from another, actually is going to school, attending school in another district, but we are required by law to share that transportation cost. So we have those. They're living and breathing. And what makes that very, very challenging is where they are located. And they need to become to school at the same time everybody else is. So it's how do you get there and service the needs of the other students that you have.
One follow-up. When you say that things may change during the year, and especially, is that because of physical needs or behavioral issues?
It could be either or. It's typically behavioral issues, typically.
Anybody else?
Okay. Thanks,
okay.
Mike.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Hope you feel better.
Oh, I will.
I know.
It's inevitable, I will.
Yeah. Rose says she does all the hard work.
Okay, our next cost center is technology and Bob Hickey.
Good evening, everyone.
This is your Kate's favorite. I didn't know it.
Mr. Hickey.
I am.
I've been waiting all night for you.
That's excellent.
Thank you so long.
I don't know. Sorry, it's been a long evening for you. I'll try and make this as brief as possible. So, of course, a tech guy can't go anywhere without home movies, so we've got the PowerPoint.
Can you move that? Can you move the wire?
Oh, sure.
Cable.
So the school mission, how does the technology department as a support division of the RSU support the rest of the district? And in many ways, we support 21st century skills, risk, project-based learning through YouTube, mass customized learning. We have mass customized applications, which allow us to get to mass customized learnings. In my earlier years here, I was somewhat frustrated in we have many things that do pretty much a similar end. So in trying to reel that in, I realized the folly that each school, each class, teacher, they have the applications they have for a reason. For example, distance education, we have virtual high school at the high school. We have Moodle throughout the district. We have new this year, eBackpack. We've had Edmodo at the middle schools. And since each application addresses different needs, different ways by different teachers and different students, we are supporting mass customized learning. We are getting to what the students need. And we have really strengthened the relationship between the tech department and the curriculum department. I'll get into more details on that later. We've strengthened the relationship between the tech department and our wonderful facilities director and the facilities department as well. We've had major projects that are funded through Bill's budget. There's only two items that I'm going to seek funding for this year, and one of them is in Bill's capital improvement budget, and I'll get into that later. But we have worked hard to become a seamless support network for the staff, the students, the district as a whole, the community. We do things such as professional development support with ProTracks. We do support for Scholastic, IXL, FastMath. So both literacy and math literacy programs we support, discovery videos. I did an informal poll just a couple days ago on what we're using for typing software, and we're using at least a half a dozen different ones. And to the teachers' credits and the school's credits, some of them are using free applications through the web that the tech department helps to support. We do emergency notifications through Blackboard. So we are supporting standards-based learning. We are supporting the efforts for curriculum mapping. We are supporting the subcommittee that is looking into what we're going to do for standards-based learning applications, so putting the vendors through the paces. And whatever it is that that committee decides under Christine's direction, we will support. We have a one-to-one ratio of computers to students, thanks to support from this board, administration, staff, the community, from grades 3 through 12. We have supported four-year-old machines that we've purchased from the state, three different generations at this point, the $47 MacBooks last year, the G4s before that, and the iBook G3s before that at each $48 apiece. So while this is great that we've gotten the ratios of computers to students up, and it allows the technology to be in the hands of the students, utilized by the teachers to do mass customized learning, address student needs. What I've noticed, too, in my tenure here, I'll be here 10 years in September, is that when I first arrived, we targeted machines 5 years old and older to be replaced. And now we're buying machines that are 4 years old from the state, and we generally get another 4 years out of them. So by and large, we're getting 8 years out of machines. We support SubFinder for scheduling substitutes, ADS Financials. We are about to go through what's called an ENCODE upgrade. It's a ADS Financial System upgrade. We're going through a meeting to that tomorrow to kick the ball off on that, and that will happen over this summer. Automated e-backpack. And now to get back to my friend, Mr. Hansen. A couple of years ago, we implemented, with his help, a climate control system in our server room. It was ridiculously hot. The servers were getting beaten up. The chips were taking a beating from the heat and the lack of humidity control. So with his help and support, along with funding from the board, we were able to do that. This past summer, we put in a UPS system, uninterruptible power supply, and it's a commercial grade. It's a massive thing that can keep all our servers up for 2 to 3 hours while power switches over to the generator in the high school. That was a big win. This year, this past summer, we bought from different districts 1,330 MacBooks at $47 a piece, an investment of $62,510. And we rode around a state in a U-Haul and picked them up. We're trying to do everything we can to support the district as cheaply as we can and as validly as we can. And I don't want to, you know, fall into the pattern of repeating what my predecessors hear about how facilities has, you know, been on a tight budget and gone a little bit further than it should have, how buses are, but know that the computers are too. That's why I'm mentioning the ages. We have swapped control of educational software from the tech department to the curriculum department. Discovery videos, EduVision, video streaming, those have been transferred to Christine's budget out of curriculum, and we have analyzed with her what is being underutilized. Software applications that were underutilized have been removed from the budget. And, boy, I could sure talk fast, can't I? Smarter Balance assessment is coming up in the spring of next year. This is the replacement for NWEA. The tech department supports that as well. Now looking to the cost centers for significant increases, I mentioned two projects. One is $150,000 in the facility's long-term capital budget for disaster recovery and switches. We have switches that are very, very old. We have some in Raymond that I estimate are around 15 years old, could be older. We have our core switch, our most important switch that does the maximum switching as things come in and out of the internet and across our WAN. And that thing was here before I started 10 years ago. So as I mentioned in the past, we would replace PCs at 5 years. We've got core gear that is 10 years plus aging. So just a gentle nudge that, you know, if we can afford it, if you determine we can afford it, we really need investment in some of the capital infrastructure that supports the technology that keeps things humming. The second project is the laptops for the high school. We are on the netbooks now. They are on year four. They had a 3-year warranty. Pam Hecker's done a great job of keeping them humming, repaired, and working. In my original design, I never intended to get more than 4 years out of them. We didn't spend that much on them. The whole capitalized project was $550,000 to get 1,000-plus kids machines. And after 4 years, they're ready for an upgrade. So the high school has really... Oops, I forgot to do my slides. The high school has really pushed for MacBook Airs as a replacement. So I will come over some slides on that in just a few minutes. We have 600-plus staff and students hitting the guest network. So we have the regular network for regular traffic, school-issued machines, and then now in this highly connected world, almost all of us have multiple devices, smartphones, iPads, tablets, you name it. So between staff and students, there's 600 folks hitting the guest wireless network. And even going out the guest wireless network, we're still required to filter. So we have to have licenses for those. And you can imagine the cost at $12 a piece for filtering licenses. And we use a high-end filter like this called WebSense. And the reason we do that is we have had an ongoing problem where students being students, they will go to what's called a proxy site. So when they go out of our network, our filter filters, okay, you're going to someplace inappropriate, that's not allowed. When they go to a proxy site, they go from A to B and then from B to C, and we have no control. That's outside of our network. Well, that's been a chronic problem for us and other districts, other businesses, and so we put in, implemented a solution, WebSense, to solve it, and we have, we get reporting every day how some scamp or another is trying to go to places they're not supposed to, and then it goes back to Mrs. Hecker, who forwards it back to generally the high school, sometimes the middle school student administrators, and it's dealt with. So we have a very vast network. It's very complicated. It's very in-depth, and it's doing a great job. We have 3,400 students, 750 staff, and I've mentioned this in past board meetings, roughly 4,000 people. So we are serving roughly what Unum South Portland is serving. And we certainly don't have the staff or the equipment or the budget, nor probably should we. But just to let you know the scope of what we're dealing with. There is a savings of roughly $26,000 per year. We've migrated from Time Warner to Network Main, excuse me. We lose access to that E-rate reimbursement, but with E-rate, we're at roughly a 50% reimbursement, so we're saving the half that we don't have to pay for. We lose the other E-rate half. So we've done customized programming for attendance for the lower grades and more recently for the high school. And this was at the behest of Kelly DeVoe. She came up with the overall design, and we programmed it. And thanks to Chris for the accolades, he estimates it saves his staff 20 hours a week of chasing students down who have absence issues. I haven't done customized programming for the middle schools yet, but that will be the next target. And Chris has also requested some customized programming to notify families of lower grades for students at risk. So that's in the works as well. The iPads have worked pretty well this year. There was some growth in the beginning. The teachers seem to be getting used to them. The kids love them, of course. They're very interactive devices. Peter and Austin are two Mac guys. They use Jamf software. It's provided by the state for free. And what that allows is if a student is downloading applications that they're not supposed to, because they can take them home and do that, they're outside of our filter once they're home, then this can detect it, shut them down, notify the teacher. So that's pretty good. We are working currently on iRead. It's a new Scholastic program this year. iRead is very interactive, and it holds a lot of exciting potential. We've had some system issues. We've upgraded our network. We're utilizing our VDI, our virtualization, to help support that as well. There's still some tuning that needs to happen with that. We just put in an accelerator yesterday. Aaron Hamlin, our network administrator, did that. So once we get that fine-tuned, that should be quite exciting. And we've improved wireless at RES. In the last week, we've thrown in five more wireless access points to support the applications. And Wyndham Primary, we threw in two this week. And I did want to throw out that the meetings are not fully ported to Granicus yet. I know there was interest in that, but that's not quite ready. But Gary Harriman, our district videographer, is going to put them out on EduVision and have links from the website. So they won't be live, but people will be able to watch them stream through the internet later, as well as through Channel 7. And we'll keep working on that till we get them live as well. So at this point, I'm ready for any questions you may have.
Jennifer.
You had talked about upgrading the high school students' laptops.
Uh-huh.
You briefly mentioned MacBook Airs that they were pushing for. Is that what you're budgeting for?
Right, yes. And that comes in at $312,355 a year times 4 years. It comes out to almost perfectly $1.25 million. It's just under.
Okay, and that's for all grades?
That's for the 4 years in high school plus teachers. And then when you go through the MLTI program, you also get a wireless network for the high school. And in addition, you would get Apple TVs, just like the middle schools have gotten for those teachers. So.
Okay.
Yep.
What are we doing with the netbooks?
The netbooks, they don't really have a destination yet. We talked about moving them to the lower grades. Raymond really isn't too interested in that. Wyndham Primary has some interest in that. But as we're getting, you know, almost one-to-one down to the very low grades, there's not a lot of demand for them.
I think in the beginning there was some discussion on, you know, what do we do with them afterwards, and I think part of that was, well, maybe we make them available for the kids. So maybe seniors might want to.
I remember being mentioned. I don't think we had a big
I don't remember having a big conversation. I just don't know.
Toby brought that up.
Yeah, I remember that. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know what would happen, but anyway, okay. Go ahead, Jerry.
Bob, you mentioned this capital infrastructure. Is that in this budget, that you're like the switches that are old?
Yes.
Oh, it is. Okay.
Yeah,
how much is that?
$150,000 in Bill's budget.
Is that this disaster recovery setup?
It's disaster recovery and switches both.
Okay, well, so can you tell me what the disaster recovery is?
Sure. If there was a fire in our network room right now, we would be hurting. So what we're going to do, if this is funded, is to move a minimal amount of our servers into the disaster recovery site. The core switches, which is ancient, we would put there, and we hope that this site would never be used because that core switch is beyond maintenance. We can't call Cisco or anybody and say, help us configure this, or it's burned up, help us get another one. It's not supported anymore. It's so old. So our new one would go in the high school, and then we would have minimal systems in the disaster recovery site, which we are targeting. The current computer office where Mike Pelletier works out of the primary school, because it's a big rugged building and it's on campus. So as we move data back and forth between high school and primary school, if we needed to, we don't have to pay for a leased line. We own the line. We own the land. So that's the cheapest way out with the most fortified building. And then at some point in the future, Bill would have to plan for a generator of some sort to keep those up.
Well, along those lines, so right now everything's in one room?
Yes.
You don't have a backup?
Correct.
And that's protected by water?
Protected by...
You got a sprinkler system in it?
Yes.
Any thought on that, changing that? I know I'm kind of...
I guess I can speak to this briefly. Bill and I have chatted about this before. It makes us nervous having water sprinkler heads over expensive computers, but he said that we're required by law to have it. We really can't get rid of it. Bill is very smart. Maybe he'll figure a workaround, but that's my understanding of it.
Well, you could put a dry suppressor in, or you could do a pre-action.
Correct. Right. That's, again, the long list of things we have to do.
Yeah.
One of the
What was your talk about disaster recovery? Made me think about it.
Good point, Eric.
You all set, Eric?
Yeah, sorry.
Terry? Okay, so just to look at your budget, you're up 18%. I see the change is $234,000 from the year before, although you're asking for $312 plus $150, so you must have cut somewhere to be able to do that.
Well, we're one staff person less than last year, and like I say, as we move things from my budget in the last year over to Christine's, it looks like I'm cheaper when I'm really not. You're okay. Moving from the left pocket to the right. So.
But Jerry, you are asking for the 312 plus 150 is a increase.
The 150 is in Bill's budget, though, as I understand it.
Okay, that's in your budget. Okay, so the 312 is in your budget. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Mrs. Brooks. Always a pleasure.
Oh, thanks.
First of all, thank you for keeping all the balls in the air. This is probably one of the most complex departments in that it's the most rapidly moving department of all, and it's changing so quickly. So I appreciate what you and your staff are doing to keep the train moving. Back to the high school with the MAC Airs. Was there any discussion, this is going to be one-on-one, was there any discussion about giving students the option of bringing their own device, or are we committed to one-on-one?
We had talked about that with Mr. Prince, Mr. Howell, and I, and some others. The issue with that is we're kind of afraid to pull the trigger on that in this economy where there's so many people who couldn't afford to bring their own device.
Well, I'm not suggesting that if you can't afford it, you don't get a device. I'm just suggesting that if you can't afford it, we don't have to buy you a device.
Right, right.
You see what I'm saying?
I
but
do
I guess
see
we're
what
not
you're
there.
Saying. Yeah.
We're well, not there
it
yet.
Doesn't seem like we're quite there yet.
All right. The other thing with the Mac Airs, since we're kind of changing platforms, are there any other additional expenses? I'm not a computer guru, but I mean, I'm thinking in terms of printers, and I mean, do what we have, the infrastructure, is that compatible with the Mac Airs?
Well, once we get the improved wireless network, what we have now for wireless is called 802.11n. And it's rated for streaming video through the air, which is pretty good. The problem is that once you start passing out all these devices and all the Apple TVs, and the Apple TVs are streaming a lot of data individually, and then you put them room to room where they're streaming different things, it puts a lot of data through the air. So that's why the state is coming forth with what's called 802.11ac, which is the next generation beyond N, so it can better deal with multiple streaming of video through the air in addition to regular traffic, et cetera. So, do we have the wireless network now to support it? No. And we are doing things at, you know, what we estimate to be minimal cost. There's no real buffer in there, so we believe it's going to be okay. And in the last year, working with Mr. Davis and the printer vendor, we have gotten an awful lot of new printers, so a lot of our old printer inventory is gone. So we should be all right with printers and network and devices.
Okay. Good. Thank you.
Yeah. Just so I can be clear, can you reiterate what the situation is at the high school? Like, what do they have currently? Is the lease expiring on those? What do they have for equipment?
For switches?
No, for the devices.
The laptops.
Oh, the laptops? Yeah. We bought those. They're netbooks. They're Dell netbooks. They're tiny little devices. And we bought those. It will be 4 years, July 1 coming up, the implementation. So we bought those just before July 1 of 2010.
Were they new at the time, or were they?
They were brand new at the time. We got them, and we got a good price on them, and then last minute, Dell said, we'll make you an offer where we can give you touch screens on them for free. And so I said, why not give those to the touch screens to the kids? Let's do it. And it turned out to be one of the worst decisions I've ever made. There's a little filmy covering over the screen. It's very delicate. It breaks all the time. And it created a lot of breakage. So trying to do a good thing, I went left when I should have gone right. It is. Other questions, Pete?
Amazing. Very good.
All right, great. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you. You do a lot of work with a very small staff, and we really appreciate it because you service an awful lot of people.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Really. Okay. Very good. Okay. We are now ready for the public participation. And we don't have any public participation this evening. Wow, that is amazing.
It's snowing.
And again, and this is just a reminder to the new members of the board. When Don sent his information out, he wasn't just being nice. He really will sit with, if you have the time and you want to go in and see him. I know, because my first year, I spent a lot of time in his office.
Yeah.
Because, you know, how do you read this book? You know,
it's
a lot of book. It has, what is it, over 2,200 budget lines in it. So it's a lot of information. So if there's anything, and then.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm happy to do that.
Again, you're going to send the information that you send out, like the
to all.
We'll go to all.
Yes, Chair.
Just, I'm clarifying what we're doing next week and the week after. Do we get an updated timeline at all?
Should have.
Is this it? I think it is.
Next week, Jordan's small middle school in the gym. And
I know where it is.
But there's some changes, right? We have to be there at 5:30, correct? Are we?
Yes.
Emails, are it possible? Do we know for sure if we're doing the?
Well, we're waiting to see if everybody can. So far, I think most of you can be there at 5:30. Mm-hmm. So,
I think it was okay. Most of.
So we start at 6:30, and then Don has to be in there. I'm just trying to see who's on next week. Don's going to be on there at some point next week.
At the end, actually, let me just pass this
I
down so you can take a look.
I didn't get it.
Well, I haven't got an updated one.
You haven't? Okay.
We'll no. Probably start at 5:30, but we're waiting to see.
Oh, so 6 or 7. Okay, could you send this out because we don't have.
I don't have this. Do you have the sabbatical at 6:30?
Yeah.
So that would just be helpful to have. And then the next week stays.
That
the same.
Would be great.
Saturday stays the same, though. Thank the 29th does
note?
Not be yeah. Different.
That note. This is a Cindy thing.
It shouldn't change.
Okay. It should be the same.
Yes.
Okay. The 29th should, and of course, we wouldn't have had all the changes we had if we hadn't had a quasi snow.
And I just have another question. Is our budget public meeting late this year? Is it usually that late in May? I don't, or that close to the budget validation, or is it usually?
Pretty much the same time.
Okay. Okay. Then.
Don't have anything. We are okay. All. We are
so
all.
So you will let us know exactly when to be there, what's going
Wednesday
on.
Wednesday, then Saturday, then Wednesday.
So we are all set.
All right.
Just great. Straight.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank
you. We need to vote or anything?
Not in a work, no, not in a workshop. Thank you.
Oh, do we have to adjourn?
No.
Thank you.